Good afternoon, and we are going to talk about that the festival that we are presenting is now starting a new tradition, whereby about 2 weeks before the festival, we try to talk about the festival. We try to gather the artists who will be participating in the festival. We try to interview them in depth and a few will heard about some of the dance styles, Kathak and Manipuri and Bharatanatyam, and you are curious and you want to develop a better understanding so that vaguely you feel drawn to these classical forms, but you are not quite sure what it is all about. So we invite you to our open house. We said the doors are open, you simply have to enter. And we are here to cater to all your needs. We'll not only interview the artists and that relationship festival, you will come. We are going to show you some clips of dancing, not only from the performers who are going to perform at the festival, although that is going to be done because we wanted to form a certain familiarity with the look and feel for the dance. You want to make up your mind taken part in the classical performances. Those who are veterans, those who have seen classical dance forms, and even the performers who will be performing the festival before, for them it's a homecoming. It's a reunion with the artists. And in this manner, and of course the audience will be, the potential audience will be encouraged to raise questions, to ask, to comment, potential audience. Thank you. Festival conditions were for variety of price structures that will bring out the possibilities of watching are all there on our website, and please consult our website and make up your mind so that we want to establish that relationship with the entire potential audience all over and the artists that we have selected. This warm relationship and a rather intimate relationship will be extremely helpful in building a solid, cultivated, educated, and interested audience for all the nights of the festival, and hopefully they will stay us for a long time, because Kalanidhi Festival, as Sudha has established over the last 25 years, is an ongoing event. It's not going to die. It's not going to disappear. Sudha's aim was to capture the evolving traditions. They evolved, and we are going to project and we are going to show them. But Sudha's aim was to run with the dance, to walk with the dance as it develops, to evolve with the evolving dance. And therefore we are going to bring this dance festival as an ongoing experience. Until now it was only confined to Toronto, where physically people could visit and enjoy it. Now suddenly with the help of this technology of live streaming, the doors are all open. The sunlight has come in. And it will be capable of being seen almost anywhere, wherever there is internet. So we want in the last 2 weeks before the festival, we want the potential audience to walk with us all the way to the opening of the festival, to stay with us during the festival, and then continue to stimulate the festival by their questions and comments and deeper understanding, because you will be staying with us through emails and your comments, and that will be the post-festival period. This is the idea. This is the first step that we have just begun to take. It will take a while for the idea to spread, but I hope that you will support us. I hope that you will strengthen this idea by asking questions and thereby making it or helping it to grow. There are a number of things that we want to do in the festival. As I said before, we want to introduce you and the artists. Thereby we want to carry our publicity for the festival far and wide. We also want to make it possible to hear what you have to say in terms of pricing, in terms of any other inconvenience or convenience, and all these things. Stay with us. Now, we are going to show you today, we'll begin with the dances which are those dances which are going to take place in another 4 days' time, but those dances which took place in the past festivals. We are going to dip into a very rich, incredibly rich archival footage that Kalanidhi's documenters have collected over the years. And we want to begin gently. We want to begin to give you an idea about a whole range of dances that we have presented and will continue to present. So today, the first half will consist of the excellent dance works that we have presented in the past. But at the same time, I also, since the festival is just around the corner, I also want to begin to introduce you to the dances that will be coming up. So it's going to be a mixture, an evening of mixture of dances from the past festivals and dances from the upcoming festival. Many of you watched the interview with Kasturi Mishra, the great Kathak dancer who is going to perform at the festival. This was done about 2 days ago, and I hope you got hold of it over the YouTube. We will continue to put all our recordings of the event, whatever activities take place, the Kalanidhi, the open day festival, and that we shall continue to put on the on YouTube, where you can watch it using the link that will be provided on our website. So this is what you'll do for tonight's presentations also. We will now today begin with another great Kathak choreographer, and that Kathak choreographer is both. She has lived over a long period, had great training and performing in the so-called classical Kathak. And then she grew, established a school, collected a number of dancers, particularly in Ahmedabad. The institution came to be known as Kadam. And then she herself began to ask questions about what she was doing, the kind of dance that she was performing. And an artist is always a restless soul. An artist always looks within and looks without and tries to do something that some deep-seated urge impulses. So that asking such questions, Kumudini started doing things which were not part of the traditional format of Kathak. And thereby, an output that may be called contemporary began to come out of her imagination and her work. We want to introduce, not right today only, but over the next 3 days or so, to the entire career of Kumudini Lakhia, to where she began with the traditional classical Kathak, and again at an excellent level, and then she started asking these new questions. Out of the three pieces that she presented to us in 2011 at the Kalanidhi Festival, where Sudha had invited her and we honored her for her contributions, there are three pieces in that particular repertoire, and each roughly 20 minutes long. So we are going to start with the first piece, which really takes you to the excellent traditional presentation around Tatkar. It's excellent. Just enjoy it. Absorb it. Because when we come tomorrow and then later on, you will be introduced to other incarnations of Kumudini. Her I normally want to divide an artist's journey into starting with classical, then you get into what may be called neoclassical, which my sister Menaka has distinctly showed, and then you get into contemporary, which is far deeper, because you ask deeper questions about something that you had taken for granted all your life when you studied classical. It may not be to everyone's liking, and yet it is important to understand, because that really speaks of the inner growth of a great artist. We shall discuss the whole notion of contemporary on Sunday, when we are going to have a symposium on 2nd of April, Sunday. This whole area is growing. There's a lot of chaos in it. But chaos is absolutely needed, because chaos is the first point, the first step in something worthwhile that will newly emerge. There are a number of different interpretations even of the term contemporary. And we want to discuss that. We want to discuss something which is really valuable, that is growing, but nothing valuable can come out of an established tradition unless there is a stirring and almost a chaotic feeling. Because nothing comes ready-made, you have to make it. All these things are spread all over the festival, and this is something I would like to really emphasize, that we all, and Sudha in particular, was very conscious of the widespread of Indian dance. It is excellent in its traditions which have come down to us from centuries ago. It is excellent in its performing. It is excellent in its changes in the tradition and something that distinctly grows out of tradition, but it is not exactly like the tradition, and I would like to call that neoclassical, the new classical. That's an absolutely essential stage through which most creative people have to pass. And then we might call contemporary, but what exactly is the meaning of contemporary? There are different historical trajectories over which the artists have grown, and you are not going to be able to expect the same sense of contemporary as it emerges in different dance genres, whether it is the Western ballet or what is called Western contemporary. But then Indian dance also has gotten into its field of contemporary, but it is not Western contemporary, it is Indian contemporary. The historical traditions have been different, and therefore a certain temper, what may be called a contemporary temper, a contemporary, because we are in an evolutionary stage. The whole humankind is evolving, it is passing through different rungs of evolution, and therefore it is going to be different. Chinese, operatic, Afro-Caribbean, all of them, you cannot expect the same sense of contemporary in its look and feel, or even in its aesthetic. But it really represents one characteristic of contemporary dance, and that is something within you has stirred. You are not going to simply be absorbed in a mold, in a vocabulary, in a sense of what is relevant or what concerns you. And that is the beginning, and then you are going to go into something new which may not please you, and yet it is valuable because it is a growth, and growth always will have so many redundant, unnecessary things that grow with it, and they have to drop out, they have to fall by the roadside at some point. It is only eventually after this that what comes out is the valuable new awareness, a new understanding, a new perspective. We'll talk about all these things throughout the festival, because the festival following Sudha's method has been curated around a kind of a sense of balance, so that we are going to have balance between the traditional, the neoclassical, and the contemporary in our festival. There'll be a regional balance that will be struck as Indian dance comes out. And remember now, the regional balance is not only between South India and East India and West India and North India. The regional balance calls for a balance between what comes out of Indian dance in, say, Canada and England and France and Germany and Australia and Singapore. These have become important regions where Indian dance is flourishing. And that sense of a whole world growing around the basic principles of Indian dance, but now developing their own wrappings, because they come, they flourish in the midst of other cultures, and therefore they are going to borrow, they are going to absorb the important elements of these other cultures. It is a very interesting phase that Indian dance is going through, and Sudha had decided that we are going to give you a sense of the totality of Indian dance as it is developing in the entire diaspora that is far flung, scattered all over the world. I should now withdraw, because I've spoken enough and I've given you a sense of what is to follow in the entire festival. Not only on the last day of the symposium, but the entire festival is going to be strewn with the classical and the neoclassical and the contemporary. Every evening, in fact. I'll talk more about this later today, but also more importantly tomorrow, as to the structure of the festival. Let us now get back and watch Kumudini Lakhia's, and remember, it's a three-piece choreography. So the first piece begins with the roots, excellent roots, and then we'll go into other things. So I'll come back to introduce some other dancers this evening, but first of all, let's begin with Kumudini Lakhia's Upaj, as it was presented and 2011 at the Kalanidhi International Dance Festival. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was Kumudini Lakhia's choreography, Upaj. As I told you before, it's a full, complete 60-minute piece. This is just the beginning of it. And I think it's a very good, very interesting, and probably very apt beginning, because here, of course, Kathak is totally recognizable in its look and feel and its movements. It is Kathak, but rather differently placed, maybe even differently costumed. Maybe the musical accompaniment is different from what you might normally expect in a Kathak performance. So that gradually you see how a choreographer coming from a long tradition can try to grapple with the tradition on the one hand and try to give it a new look and feel slowly. I think we'll try to get to see Kumudini Lakhia's other works, but particularly this 60-minute piece in the next 2 days also, so that we have seen the first part today, and then we'll try to see the other two parts tomorrow and the after. Hopefully before our festival begins on Tuesday. I also now want to take you into another very imaginative choreographer from England, an Indian dance company, Srishti, but flourishing in a very rich dance atmosphere of England. And there, once again, you'll get a new sense of how contemporary dance grows in a genre that has a very, very long and a solid tradition. And as I remarked before, because of the length of the tradition and because of its diversity, the elements that now come up to dominate the contemporary choreography are bound to be diverse. Contemporary choreography cannot carry only one meaning of the term. And as we shall notice, it can be contemporary only in terms of sort of the new ways of using the traditional vocabulary. It may be contemporary in dealing or interpreting in dance different themes which are more relevant to the contemporary society. You see, in the traditional choreography, we often find that the subjects are often gods and goddesses and stories from the Mahabharata and Ramayana and so on. Traditional world is presented to you, although you don't live in that traditional world. The world may be far apart. Your surroundings may be far apart, and therefore some of the elements of what you see in the dance may not even be a part of your own life experience. And yet, they are very interesting. You have inherited them. You have inherited those ideas and those values in its own growing up, because we have had, particularly in India, we have had a very strong contact with our own past, with our own values, traditions, and in some parts, even in the look and feel. The next piece that we are going to show is called Bend It. It is the outcome of the creativity of the choreographer and the musician of that company, Srishti. Nina Rajarani, trained in Bharatanatyam, is the choreographer. Yadavan, her husband, is an excellent vocalist of the Karnataki style. And he has been a very strong foundation on which most of the musical structure is laid. The theme that they have chosen, I will not speak about it to you. You'll notice what the theme is. So let's, one thing, this particular choreography had won the first prize in the choreographic competition that was for all Europe. The European Open Competition on Choreography, there Srishti and the two choreographers, Yadavan and Nina Rajarani, they have been placed number one. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello. This dance, presented by Srishti from England, is an excellent example of what one can do with the received dance vocabulary, the movement vocabulary, and piece it together to express a theme of sort of common contemporary experience, a football match, soccer. And this was done with such precision, such adherence to the Tala system, the jatis, the movement of Bharatanatyam vocabulary, and so on, so forth, and so on. But at the same time, the theme was so excitingly this theme of soccer, sports. Not all contemporary choreographies developed this way. We are trying to show you the variety and diverse ways in which people are approaching their older tradition and give it a new look. There's going to be Friday night in the festival, 31st of March. That is going to be devoted to what generally may be called contemporary choreography. The first night, the opening night, is going to show you a variety that comes, it is traditional in many ways, but it comes from more obviously looking traditional vocabulary. I will come back to the opening night and talk more about it in detail a little later, but just want to give you an idea as to how the upcoming festival is structured night after night. The second night, as I remarked last time, is going to be devoted to Kathak, and we have given the title Kathak in Transition, because we want to begin with the so-called glorious traditional choreography and traditional presentation of Kathak, and then move on and to see how it has been developing. The third night is going to be devoted to Odissi, and once again I'll come back to talk about it. But right now I want to talk more about the fourth night, the night of the contemporary work in Indian dance, and we gently began with a slight departure from the Kumudini Lakya's first piece, although we'll come back to other pieces of Kumudini ji. And the second coming out of England was this Srishti's Bandit. The third piece that we want to show you tonight, called Game of Dice, choreographed by Santosh Nair from New Delhi, that also is going to be presented at the festival on Friday night, the 31st of March. And we are going to give you a glimpse into how Santosh Nair's mind works, how he looks upon tradition with very great authenticity, but how he then interprets it, or how he uses the traditional dance to express an age-old theme. It comes from Mahabharata, actually. Draupadi Vastraharana, very, very famous piece. When Queen Draupadi of the Pandavas was disrobed in the open court by Dushasana, the evil Kaurava, to insult her, and how in the game of dice that preceded the insult, how the Pandavas had lost themselves, they had become the slaves of the Kauravas, because they had put themselves as the stakes in the game, and they were won over by crafty Shakuni. So they could not help their own wife, their own queen, when she was in great distress of being disrobed, and the insult of the highest order on a woman was going to be heaped on her. Then she prayed to Lord Krishna, And Lord Krishna invisibly supplied her sari after sari so that Dushasana, who was pulling the sari, trying to disrobe her, finally got completely tired. And then he had to sit down, but Draupadi was not short of sari at all. This is the original story and the original theme. How do you express it? And I'm sure many of you have seen the dance interpretation of this story many times, in a variety of ways, by dancers from different genres, whether it was in Bharatanatyam or Kathak or Odissi, wherever. Now we are going to see how Santosh Nair, making a combination of the newly installed as a classical dance, Chhau tradition, and combines that also with some elements of Kathakali. This is the Chhau variety of the three varieties of Chhau. This is the Chhau variety where they use masks to create characters and in some sense even to hide them in some essential ways. How do you handle a face when it is hidden, replaced by a mask, and yet you want to bring out all the emotions that normally emerge out of a dance interpretation? This is what Santosh is going to show. I really would like all of you to attend the full show, 55 minutes, on the opening night, 28th of March. But tonight here, we are going to give you only a glimpse. Thank you very much. It will take 45 seconds. Yeah. Yeah, I guess we'll have to wait for a few seconds because it's being downloaded. Santosh performed this piece a few years ago in Kalandi Festival, but it was so captivating, it mesmerized the people, and there was a constant inquiry as to when we would bring Santosh back. We brought Santosh as a choreographer back 2 years ago in another production called Mystical Night. And again, we are going to give you a glimpse into Mystical Night a little later on. I'm sorry, are you ready? Yeah, Mystical Forest. To mention, is Santosh's actual dancers, his troupe, did come to Toronto on the past occasions when we presented Mystical Forest and Game of Dice a few years ago. Tonight and also in the festival, they are not physically present. They are going to be live streamed into the festival. It will be an encore performance of a performance that took place in New Delhi, and that is what you are going to see here. So this is going to be a typical example of the advantages of live streaming, where you can really bring things all over the place, and also how we can reach distant multiple locations where audiences are seated. Thank you very much, and we are ready to go now.
History of our land. From time immemorial, great minds have been born and nourished and inspired to heroic deeds by the Mahabharata. Vyasa's epic is one of our noblest heritages, one that strengthens the soul and underlines, as nothing else does, the vanity of ambition and evil, and the futility of anger and hatred. The Mahabharata belongs not only to India, but to the world, transcending as it does regionalism, and through it, the essential oneness of the human family. Makes it a matter of honor and etiquette, accepts the invitation. The dice rolls in, and with it does depravity in the form of lust, pride, avarice, prejudice, and the absolute loss of reason. A turning point in the great epic. Shakuni's scheming mind wreaks havoc on peace. Duryodhana becomes a slave to perverse pride. The lustful Dusasana revels in the vilest of deeds. Yudhishthira is reduced to a mere puppet. The high-souled Pandavas, despite godlike strength, are subjected to unprecedented suffering. Draupadi, the most unfortunate of queens, bears agonizing humiliation. Krishna's scintillating divinity and purposefulness pervade the whole epic. Indeed, it is difficult to find anywhere such vivid portraiture on so ample a canvas. Gospel on Dharma, the Mahabharata has molded the character and civilization of one of the most numerous of the world's people. Its lessons are many, the most enduring of them being that hatred begets hatred, that covetousness and violence lead inevitably to ruin, that the only real conquest is in the battle against one's own lower nature. Thank you.
in the temple of Jagannath in Orissa in East India.
flow. That mesmerizing piece was from Game of Dice by Santosh Nair from New Delhi. This is one example of what goes under the name of contemporary Indian dance. As I said before, there are a variety of examples of contemporary dance. And because it goes under a single name, people are often confused as to what to expect. The theme, of course, is age-old from Mahabharata. Its interpretation and its vocabulary is going to be astoundingly varied. I would very much like all of you to come on the first evening and watch contemporary Game of Dice in its entirety. 55 minutes on the first evening. In fact, first evening is going to be one of the most powerful evening. And I think you'll get a glimpse into Abhinaya in a very different way, very innovative Abhinaya by Menaka. And then contemporary dance by Santosh, this very piece. And very graceful lyrical traditional Odissi piece by Sujata Mohapatra. Please come. I shall talk a little more about what Menaka is going to present a little later. But now back to what we are doing this evening. We are dipping into a variety of meanings and a variety of approaches to what's called contemporary. But now for a while, maybe for another 15 or 20 minutes, we shall come out of this contemporary and we shall try to go back to the beauty of the traditional dance, Odissi dance, very lyrical. Again, I shall not go into details of Odissi, its discovery outside of the state of Orissa, its reconstruction and regeneration, all these things which mark the early part of the 20th century. It's a very fascinating history of Indian dance. We say it's thousands of years, it is indeed. But there have been periods where it has disappeared for a while, it has fallen into another tract altogether, often not respected by society and so on. As the same historical sort of development and traditional historical moments which have been shared by many other dance traditions. And now it comes up back to us in all its lyrical glory in the 20th century and now continuing with us in the 21st. Gita Govindam. Lots of people have seen it. A number of people have experimented with Gita Govindam, if not with the entire classical poetry of the 12th century, but they've taken pieces called the Ashtapadis from Gita Govindam and set them to dance, whether it is in Bharatanatyam, Odissi, Kathak, everywhere. It is the eternal story of love between Radha and Krishna, and of course it has its own spiritual significance and spiritual interpretation. But poet Jaidev presented it to the public in such details and such attractive metaphors and symbols and attractive love pictures that he drew with his words, that Gita Govindam had stood the time, the test of time, and it has remained an eternal favorite with artists of various different followings. Not only in dance, certainly in music, the Ashtapadis of Gita Govindam have always been set to beautiful classical music, both in the North Indian classical system and the north, the Karnataka system of the south. Dance has been very favorite way of expressing Ashtapadis, but it has also inspired other arts such as painting and the miniature paintings which took place around the 18th century at the king at the court of the King Samsar Chand in the Kangra Valley. They have become very popular, very famous. They are so beautiful and lyrical. And when we decided, that is Manaka, and we decided to do something about the entire theme of Gita Govindam, not only the individual pieces, but the entire theme of Gita Govindam, taking the poetry from the beginning till the end, we decided that we are going to incorporate not only dance, although the dance will be dominant and central, but around it and supporting it will be the products of the other art forms, such as painting, such as music, the narration, the poetry itself, the sounds of the Sanskrit poem and its translation into English. All these were to be combined in Manaka's vision so that we can give total justice to Jayadev's vision of the 12th century that has stood the test of time for all these centuries. We are told that the poetry of Gita Govindam not only was a landmark in the Sanskrit literature, the poetic literature, but it also expresses the fervor of the ardor of the bhakti, the devotion of people to Lord Krishna in such a way that it has been sung every day, each day in the worship of Lord Krishna, in the temples of Orissa, each day for the last 8 centuries. It is astounding. It provides a continuity with the last 8 centuries. So we decided to go back to Guru Kelucharan Mahapatra's compositions of each individual Ashtapadi. We tried to bring them into a whole. So we tried to stitch them together. Manaka choreographed on the missing links. Guruji's own son, Ratikanta Mishra, was brought in to provide additional choreography. And Manaka set out to envision how it would look as though Krishna and Radha were right on the banks of the Yamuna. The whole scenic design, and that is not a static design, but it's a kind of moving design, that was worked out by Toronto's artists, Sila Von Tiedemann. And all these things were brought together, and we decided to give it an English narration, but not only English narration that will explain what's going on to the audience, but we also decided to give people a taste of the sounds of the Sanskrit poem. All this woven together, Manaka choreographed this originally in 1976. And she performed as a one-woman interpretation supported by the slides from the paintings of Kangra Valley. But then she turned it into a group choreography. And for the last, I believe, about 10 to 12 years, it is the group choreography that is being presented, keeping all the other elements of the original work as they were. So in this festival, we are going to show you not only the contemporary choreography of the 21st century, as you will see in Game of Dice and other pieces, but we are also going to take you back to the roots of some of these things. In Kathak, we are going to take you to the roots of Kathak, or the traditional Kathak that Kasturi will perform, Kasturi Mishra. And in Odissi, we are going to take you back to Manaka's choreography of Geeta Govindam, 12th century AD. And of course, Sujata herself will give her memorable solo Odissi piece based upon Ramacharitamanasam by Tulasidas. So it is really a balance between the classical, the neoclassical, the contemporary. That is this festival. And I really feel you should take it all 5 nights and 2 afternoons of this festival. I'll again come back to talk a little more about the structure of the festival, but now we go back from the contemporary to the lyrical classical tradition of Odissi, Geeta Govindam, choreographed by Manaka and heavily supported by Ratikant Mahapatra, based upon Guruji's original Ashtapadis. And the magical fact, of course, also is that the lead dancer is Sujata Mahapatra, Radha. Thank you very much.
Sung each day for the last 8 centuries. Among the literate, this long love poem called Geeta Govinda, which is something between a lyric and a drama, has stood unrivaled in Sanskrit literature. Among others, it has become an expression of the order of their own devotion to Lord Krishna, and its recitation a means of worship and prayer. All in all, this poem has held the imagination of a whole race with its rich imagery, its entrancing music, and its passionate love pictures. It stirred the creativity in other art forms. Its theme gave rise to a series of beautiful paintings in the last 4 centuries. The most magnificent of them, its various songs in the form of Ashtapadis, have come to be sung by musicians and choreographed in dance, particularly in the classical style of Odissi. The poet Jaidev was a legend in his own time. The theme of Gita Govind is the love of Krishna and Radha. Symbolically, it is perhaps the love of the outer human being for his inner soul. In its literary expression, however, the poem blends the moods of devotion and erotic love and delineates the passionate love of Krishna and Radha as it develops through various phases. The first meeting and enjoyment. Then, the estrangement caused by Krishna's love for other gopi maids. Radha's anguish at Krishna's neglect. And finally, the rapture that attends their reunion. The poet describes Radha's longing and Krishna's lovemaking with glowing sensuality, yet the poem reverts continually to praise of Krishna as God. The poem opens, following the literary traditions of the time, with a prayer to Lord Krishna, referring to his 10 incarnations, in each of which he took the form of either a human being or a beast and upheld the good and destroyed the evil. Thank you. After the prayer to Lord Krishna in his 10 incarnations is over, the poem begins. As though in a flashback, it takes us briefly to the time when the love between Krishna and Radha first arose, when they were yet very young. Meghair medu ramam varam vanabhuva shyamastamala drumai naktam bhiru rayam tvameva tadimam radhe gruham prapaya ittham nanda nidishatashchalitayo pratyadvakunja drumam radha madhavayo jayanti yabuna kule raha kelaya. The sky is overcast by thick clouds. The woodlands are black with tamala trees. This boy, Krishna, is afraid of the gloom of the night. So, oh Radha, take him home. Such was the command of Nanda, the herdsman, and thus arose the love of Radha and Krishna, who, as they passed through the forests, sported in the bowers on the bank of the Yamuna.
Radha Madhava Yor Jayanti Yamuna Kule Raha Kelaya.
The poem now leaps a period of time, a few years, and when the drama opens, a crisis has occurred. Radha, after long enjoying Krishna's passionate embraces, finds herself abruptly neglected. Charming but faithless Krishna is now pursuing other girls, and the jilted Radha wanders alone. Meanwhile, the spring has come to the forest, and the thought that others are enjoying Krishna's love tortures her to the point of madness and hinders her in all her movements. Vasante vasante kusumasukumarai ravayavai bhramantim kantare bahuvihita krishnanusaranam amandam kandarpa jvarjanita chinta kulataya valad badham radham sarasamida poochi sahachari.
Vasante vasanti kusumasukumarai ravayavai. Vasante vasanti kusuma sukumarai ravayavai. Bhramanti kanta bahubihita krishnanu sharanam aa aa. ज्वर जनित चिंता कुलतया चिंता कुलतया बलत बाधा राधा सरसमिदमुचे सहचरी
As Radha broods on her lost joys, a friend describes to her what is happening. Lalita lavanga lata parishilana komala malaya samiri madukara nikara karambita kokila kujita kunja kutiri viharati haririha sarasa vasanti nrityati yuvati janena samam sakhi virahi janasya duranti. In spring, tender malayan pond keepers of clove and huts and bowers resound with the mingled noise of bees and kokila birds. Hari, here in the forest, dwells in eager dance with the women folk. It is hard to endure being parted in spring, oh my friend. In spring, when the women of absent traders wail and lament, distracted with love, when the swarms of bees on the tidy bakula branches fill the clustering flowers. In spring, when the violent odor of musk is the scent of the tender tamala sprout, and when the color of the kimshuka flowers, the nails of the love god's fingers, tear the young hearts. Hari, here in the forest, dwells in eager dance with the women folk. It is hard to endure being parted in spring, oh my friend.
Sarasa vasante viharati.
Saw Krishna dancing with other gopi maids, and as the distant sounds of his flute kept echoing in Radha's mind, she felt tormented and crestfallen. With bitter sadness, she slowly walked away to a remote part of the forest. There, in a thicket of creepers, she sat brooding, filled with broken pride and jealousy. Thus passed a long time. Finally, when the swarms of bees encircling over her head began to hum noisily, she looked up and suddenly recalled all her past joys with Krishna. Slowly, all her happy memories came flooding over her, and she said to her friend who had just come over, "I remember Hari. The sweet of his nectar of lips kept flowing with the notes of his melodious flute. I remember Hari, with the play of his eyes and the toss of his head, his earrings kept dangling upon his..."
That was Geet Govindam, choreographed by Menaka Thakkar. Geet Govindam, the landmark in Sanskrit literature, a poem of the 12th century AD, which has remained so alive till this day. It has been expressed, as we saw, in a variety of art forms. And in this particular production, we have tried to bring into play, into one place, integrated with one another, all these art forms. I really wish, really, really hope you'll come to watch this. This is the glory of Odissi, and Sujata Mahapatra, I can assure you, is at the very top of his profession. Guru Kelucharan Mahapatra was a legendary figure. Menaka went to Bhubaneswar and Katak and sat at his feet and studied Odissi after she had become a very well-known, accomplished dancer of the Bharatanatyam style of Indian dance. Sujata Mahapatra is the daughter-in-law of Guru Kelucharan Mahapatra. And in this particular production, greatness has met with greatness in all directions. I really urge you to come Thursday night to the theater, which is the Odissi night, and watch both Sujata's solo followed by Manika's Geeta Govindam production. Once again, I want to switch from this classical tradition into something that may be called contemporary. And there are going to be several examples juxtaposed between classical and contemporary, and there will be also what I have called the neoclassical pieces, and that will be on particular on Saturday. You will see the neoclassical choreography of Manika. But I want to switch back tonight to again another example of contemporary dance. And once again, let me remind you, contemporary dance, the evening for the contemporary dance is Friday, 31st of March. And again, I want to emphasize that contemporary dance is not just one style of dance. It is contemporary only in the sense of going beyond what has been the received tradition, whether it is in Odissi, it is or Bharatanatyam or Kathak or anywhere. And it is still being experimented upon. It gives you a glimpse into the sort of mindset of those who are innovating. And again, not everything may be good, but it is the daring spirit of experimentation and bringing out something that was not part of our common experience. This piece that we are going to see now comes from a trip called Navarasa Dance, originally located in Boston, United States. Recently only they have moved to Los Angeles. Aparna Sindoor, originally from Bangalore and trained in the Bharatanatyam tradition in Bangalore. And Anil Natyaveda from Kerala. He was a martial artist, Kalaripayattu. And you'll notice that the physical vocabulary of martial art has been borrowed into dance, and that is one very, very promising aspect of the contemporary Indian dance, where the vocabulary comes from other sources where physicality of a human body has been expressed so fully. Naturally, you would expect in martial arts that martial arts and also circus arts, that the body has been used in a very rigorous way. All parts of the body, often the body is trained for a number of years, and something that seems impossible is brought out from the body. And this has been adopted in contemporary dance in almost all different genres. So you'll find contemporary dance or the use of this martial art, whether it comes from Kerala's Kalaripayattu or it comes from Thangta of Manipur, it may come from Malkham traditions in Gujarat and Maharashtra, whatever it is. And of course, Chao tradition that you saw and you are going to see once again at the festival, that Santosh has brought in. With all these various martial arts traditions, contemporary dance is in a sense going into a new direction, but also bringing the real dharma, as I would say, of the body. Angikam, something that is related deep down into the inner parts of the body. And also we know that in yoga, particularly Hatha yoga, we find that the body is treated in a very deep way. There is not one outward physical body that we use and touch and bump into. There is this subtle body, the sukshma sharira. And that plays an extremely important part at the inner level. And in Indian dance particularly, Sukshma Sharira and its applications has been recognized to a great, great extent. Anil Natyaveda and Aparna Sindur, leading this company called Navarasa Dance Theatre, they have specialized in this. And they have taken a path of mixing this Kalari tradition with folk tales of Tamil Nadu and various other parts of Kerala and various other parts of South India. They are going to appear at the festival on Friday night with a dance titled called A Story and a Song. And that will be very interesting. You'll see Kalari in its unbelievable extent. But here we are going to show another example of Anil and Aparna Sandur's choreography, and that comes from their work called Encounter. They performed this at Kalanidhi Festival about 3 years ago, 4 years ago perhaps, and we decided that that will be shown from the archival footage of Kalanidhi. So watch this. This, I believe, with this we shall end tonight's program, tonight's open house, Kalanidhi open house, and we shall again meet tomorrow. We shall again talk more about the dances which are going to appear at the festival, and we shall also have interviews tomorrow with the artists. So please come and watch and support us, because if we can go on into this live streaming tradition, particularly beyond the physically live dance on the stage, and go to multiple distant locations at prices which are almost half of the prices that you have to pay to watch a stage performance. Support us. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Rama company. Sorry, we are late. We have to find food and water. We are starving artists. Just because we are starving does not make us better artists. It just makes us sick in the stomach. We were cold in the fields, and late into the night we sing and dance for you. Still, we are starving. In this world, some people eat too much, some have nothing. First they came, they took our rivers. Then they came, they took our land. Now they want us to leave the forest altogether. But how will they catch us when the wind tells us where the military is? When every word uttered becomes a song of resistance, and every note a war cry to find food? Well, that's it for today. Let's begin the dance.
Sandra, Runa, 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 Sandra, Runa,
We just end the open house tonight. I would like to give credits to various people involved in not only choreographing, but also there's a lot of camera work involved, as you can see, particularly both in capturing the archival material, but also in capturing the live streaming itself, because in all cases we require excellent camera work and editing and so on. It of course will differ, because when I use the term archival material, it is it has been our tradition to capture on camera everything that was ever presented on the stage, and then we would keep it for purposes of research. And it is for the first time that we are now showing it in public, not for any financial gain, but just to stimulate their curiosity and their understanding. On the other hand, some of the work that you are looking at, where camera is involved, was essentially involved because the work could not have brought to this stage unless it was first, you know, captured on camera and then edited and so on. Some of the work that we have shown, which is also going to be part of the upcoming festival on 28th and going on into 2nd of April, that has involved the camera work of different different companies from India, for instance, this game of dice coming from New Delhi, etc. Some other works like Kumudini Lakhya's Uppaj that we showed you, or Geeta Govindam, these are from different cameras and different camera artists. The last piece that you saw, Anil and Aparna's work called Encounter, that was done in 2014. At that time, our camera artist was none other than Eddie Castro, because and he is also the director of live streaming for us, so that he does continue with us even before, I believe, 2014. The work that was captured on for Geeta Govindam was the work of I'm sorry, I have to admit I don't fully remember his name, but it was Declan. But many other years, almost since the beginning of Kalanidhi Festival, the camera artist who captured everything for archival purposes, which probably has not been shown publicly in this manner, that was all done by Kalanidhi's vice president, Mr. Abdullah Khandavani, who also has been a very well-known photographer, who has done work for many other on many other occasions, but he wasn't around in I think from 2011 or 2012 onwards. Luckily, he is present this in this festival, but he's not going to do any camera work. We are trying to show a retrospective of Kalanidhi's contemporary dance as it was presented over the years in Kalanidhi festivals, beginning with 1993. And there you will find the product of Abdullah Khandwani's photography. Right now, everything is in the hands of A.D. Castro, who is the technical director for us on both the photographing the works, editing, and sort of looking after all the problems and all the issues of live streaming. So we'll have to do this. We'll have to talk about particular credits to be given for particular artwork, and that we shall do for the festival as and when time comes, that is at the time of the performance. But for this this sort of pre-showing, I've got to remember with great gratitude the works of others, works of these cameramen. So thank you very much, and we'll be more careful about it. Thank you.